Welcome to worship today here at Grace Lutheran Church in Boone, North Carolina. I'm Pastor Steve, and I hope our worship service finds you well. This last week has been a really challenging one in the life of our community as we have started the process of digging out and coming to grips with the real damage done by Helene in our community. And even as I say that, I'm powerfully aware of the fact that there are many in our county that are still not yet having power or easy access to the supplies that they need. Still people in need of rescue, and lots of people we still don't know where they are. It's going to take a really long time for us to dig out from this tragedy, and yet at the same time, I find myself inspired by the stories I'm hearing from you, our congregation, the ways in which neighborhoods have come together to support each other, particularly the most vulnerable. It's just truly amazing, and I think a way in which God is with us even in this unimaginably difficult situation. The QR code on your screen is a link to our Thursday email, and maybe you've read it already, and if not, that's okay. Read it now, using the QR code on the screen. In it, I try to address the three main questions we're getting from the community and the congregation. And one is, where can I go for help? So if you need food or water or supplies, I need you to know that they're available and they're here. You can get food on campus or at the Baptist church every meal of the day. Supplies can be picked up at the high school. But there's a lot of other things happening in communities and in the county throughout. And so please follow those links to that opportunity where you can get support for yourself, especially if you're in need of an immediate thing like food or water. Now, if you're in a different position where you're thinking to yourself, all right, I've got our household sort of set, our neighborhood is good, and now I'm thinking, how can I help others? There was a second email, or really the third update was an email with how you can help. And so that is also in the Thursday email, is ideas about places that you can go and serve. Thank you so much to everybody who came out on Friday to help us receive the Lutheran disaster response trailer with all the items in it. And also the crew that went over to the woodlot to help us start the process of digging out, and also to get those pieces of equipment that we can use to help our community cleaned up and back in good working order. But there's other ways you can help too, including through Samaritan's Purse, volunteering at the high school and some at pickleball. There's just a lot of ways to serve the hospital. So follow that email, and there's different links to do that. The third question we're starting to get is people have experienced more flooding and things like that in their home. They're sort of a little overwhelmed about where to start. And there was an email from the North Carolina Synod Disaster Response, which gave us more directives about advice about things, about how exactly do you begin the process of mucking out a home, removing all the mud? How can you support neighbors and others? And there's also a wonderful array of links. So please, if you haven't had a chance to see it and you have access to internet enough to see this video, use the QR code, go over to the email, and follow through the various different links and learn about both how you can get help if you need it and how you can help where it's most needed.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin and come to God for healing, kneeling as we are able. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings at war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By grace you have been saved in the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And also with you. Let us pray. Sovereign God, you created us to live in loving community with one another. Form us for life that is faithful and steadfast. Teach us to trust like little children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. People were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We've been reading through this section of Mark's Gospel together, and it's kind of interesting. This is the third time where children are brought up by Jesus. In response to the adults not really understanding what's going on. Prior to this was an argument over marriage and divorce and things like that, and Jesus turns the attention of the disciples and the Pharisees and the crowd back to a child again. And it's a common image that he keeps using over and over and over again, maybe more so for the disciples and for us than for anyone else. But why is that? Why does Jesus use this imagery of a child? Why does Jesus use an actual child to try to help the disciples, try to help us understand what's going on as God's kingdom is dawning and emerging? And I was talking with the Bible study on Thursday about that very question. Why does Jesus keep coming back to children? And we had lots of great ideas and we wrote them all down. And where we kind of landed together was, you know, children are dependent upon others. They rely on their parents, their community, and others to make sure they've got food they need, to make sure that they're safe, and so that they can be kids. And Jesus wants us to cling on to that imagery of being a child, fully dependent on people around us, as the image that most closely aligns with what it means to be one who is claimed by God in the waters of baptism, what we call grace. To be a follower of Jesus is not to be one who has it all together and figured out, or one who has grabbed a hold of God, but instead one who resides in the care of God, one who receives a promise, and one who is dependent upon others. This week, in one way or another, each of us have felt a profound dependency. When the power goes out, there's not a whole lot we can do but wait. We wait and we hope it comes back on, and some are still waiting. Others didn't have to wait so long, but we still experience that together. I know in our neighborhood, and I've heard this story in other neighborhoods, as the power stayed off, neighbors began to, especially after the rain stopped, neighbors began to come outside. They checked on each other. They looked after each other. Neighbors realized that the only way they were going to get out is if they removed the trees themselves. And so they have tree-cutting parties and moving parties to create a way so that they could access other things. Neighbors would go out and they'd bring supplies back for each other. I was emailing with one member of the congregation, and they were one of the few that could get out of their neighborhood. So each day they'd come into town and gather up a bunch of the meals that they could get at the Baptist Church or in other places or at Alliance Bible Fellowship, and they would take the meals back for the whole neighborhood. Each and every day they did this so that everyone in the neighborhood would be fed with a warm meal. There's something that's really unsettling for us, though, that we like to be in control. We like to feel like we can be independent. It's kind of part of our rugged nature, especially as mountain folk here, and certainly as citizens of the United States. We see this as the ideal, but here in this story from Jesus, he makes it clear that being a follower of Jesus is being one who's dependent upon another, one who sees a community as one that can surround it with support and love. Several years ago, we adopted our purpose statement to share God's love so that all are served and supported. And that kind of cuts two ways for us. You know, when we developed that mission statement, we were telling stories of the impact the ministry of the congregation has had on our lives. And some of the stories were about things that we did, but more of them were about ways in which the ministry of the congregation did something for us when we found ourselves in a place of need. And what I've seen lived out in the life of you, our congregation members, this last week is this mission. This mission of sharing God's love and turning in loving service to the neighbors around us. The truth is that our communities are actually far more resilient when we work together, when we see our neighbor as a partner in a process of trying to meet the needs of the whole neighborhood. That's how this has worked this week. It's what we've had to do. And in some sense, we got to experience what Jesus was talking about, being dependent upon each other for the very sustenance of our lives and livelihood is an uncomfortable position to be in. And yet Jesus says this is the closest thing that we get to understanding the nature of our relationship with God. That God is the one that moves to us, toward us with grace. That in the end, we fall into the arms of God's grace, not by our own doing or effort, but by God's promise and God's doing. And so this week, we've had to learn some hard lessons about what it means to be dependent. And for some, that might have moved us further away from the life of faith. That might have had us question things like, where is God in all of this tragedy and hurt and sorrow? But I think for us, we understand that when we fall, God catches. And that's the promise for us today, and that's the promise for us when we die. This is the promise of grace that is actually grace. And so this week, our community fell, but we also gathered again resiliently. And we looked at the community around us and we said, how can we help? What can we do? How can we catch others as they are falling? In this beautiful combination of falling and catching each other, we get to both experience God's grace and practice God's grace at the same time. And my sense is that this is what true discipleship is all about. As uncomfortable as it might be for us, this is what it means to be a follower of Jesus, to learn and to practice the grace we have received. Amen. God, where you are.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and of life everlasting. Amen. Challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. God of our ancestors, we give thanks for the church in all times. Help us to listen for prophets of this age who bear messages that stir the church toward renewal and justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator of all, direct our lives toward the renewal and sustaining of all creation. Reveal the ways we can work alongside creation for the health and well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sovereign God, we give thanks that you are mindful and benevolent. Accompany us when hardness of heart gets in the way of justice between people and nations. Give leaders with minds for justice and hearts for compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Restoring, Lord, grant healing and wholeness to those who are sick and suffering. Work through medical professionals to diagnose and ease pain and to give life to all who seek their wisdom and experience. We pray especially, Lord, right now for those affected by Hurricane Helene in our area and all those in the surrounding counties of Western North Carolina, as well as the communities of Georgia, South Carolina, Florida, and Tennessee. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Unifying God, humans were created for relationship with the earth, its creatures, and one another. Forgive us when division threatens companionship, mutual support, and unity among us. We give thanks for the ways in which your love inspires us to build supportive communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of resurrection, you prepare a place in the kingdom through Christ's death and resurrection. We give thanks for the saints who have taken their place at your heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever. Amen. Our worship continues now with the offering. If you'd like, there's a QR code on the screen that will take you over to our Grace Giving page, where you can give in support of our mission so that all are served and supported. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, the source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Who this world.
God Almighty, God Most Merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace, follow Jesus. Thanks be to God.